how do tiny PCs like this manage to stay cool? I talked about this GEEKOM IT13 quite a bit in my previous video, and a lot of people commented that there's got to be thermal throttling issues for something that small. How can it possibly keep itself cool? First, let's check the power usage of my old Core i7 that I bought in 2020. But let's look at the heatsink in there. And it's got a decent sized cooler on top of the CPU. And I'm monitoring the power consumption using one of these TP-Link smart plugs, which I'm polling every second using a Python program that I wrote. And when this one is idling, it draws about 17 watts or so, but when I run some video recompression, that shoots up to 130 to 140 watts. So all that extra power, I'm pretty sure, is going into the CPU, which in turn is turned into heat. And let's compare that to my mini PCs. And both of these have a centrifugal blower on the top. And inside, on the back, we have a heatsink with very fine fins, but it's much less substantial than on my old editing PC. And doing the same test with this one. So this one idles around 8.5 watts, although it can get much lower. And starting that video compression from the command line, it shoots up to about 50-odd watts, and then it comes way down. And if we look at the processor utilization, that drops to about 40%. It's like, it's not even trying very hard, is it? But let's do this again, and this time looking at individual processors, and we see they all start out very busy, but then the power drops after a few seconds, and the first 12 processors just kind of go to idle, and then the rest of the processors suddenly become very busy. That's the last 8 processors. And those last 8 cores are actually the efficiency cores, which are slower than the main cores, but they use less power processing. And the first 12 are actually 6 high-performance cores, which each can show up as 2 cores because of hyper-threading. And looking at a die shot of this chip, this is actually for the desktop version, so it has more cores. This would be one of the performance cores, all the circuitry that's involved in that. And this block here is 4 efficiency cores, so this block is a little bit bigger, but it's got 4 CPU cores in it, which are much smaller. And being much smaller, they aren't as fast, but they also have far fewer transistors, so they use a lot less power, and it's easy to cram a lot more of them onto the chip. So this is the desktop version. It has 16 of these efficiency cores and 8 performance cores. The one in the GEEKOM that I'm using has got 6 performance cores and just 8 efficiency cores. And with that computer drawing 55 watts for just a few seconds and dropping down to efficiency cores and only 32 watts, well, it's not going to get very hot, because that's not very much power. Although what I've realized since then is if I start my test with a mouse click instead of from the command line, then Windows doesn't consider it a background task. And at that point, it goes full power for much longer. But still, it's only 55 watts, and that is manageable for the heatsink inside that little PC. So running my test again and logging the temperatures with this core temperature monitoring tool, I'll let that run and then I'll just run it several times in a row. So now we're seeing this cutback on the speed and the power just a little bit. So we're hitting into thermal throttling after a few minutes of running like that straight. And now I'm just going to let the PC cool down for a little bit. So here's a plot of the 14 physical cores over time. And at the hottest point, it got to almost 90 degrees for the hottest core, and then we got into basically thermal throttling, and the temperature came down a bit immediately with everything below 80 degrees. And if we look at the clock as a function of time, unfortunately these are a bit jittery because the clock moves around a bit, but we see at most about a 10% drop in clock speed, so not a huge drop in performance. And after I stopped the tests, it only took about 20 seconds for that heatsink to fully cool down, so we definitely reached steady state here. Now in the BIOS, I can also put this one into performance mode, which makes it a little bit more aggressive. And now testing in this mode, the power consumption goes to almost 80 watts, runs a little bit faster, and a lot louder. And temperature is getting to 90 degrees here. And looking at our energy plots, subtracting baseline here, we have 62 watts over baseline this time, whereas before over baseline it was just 43 watts. Energy over baseline has gone up to 5200 joules versus 4200 joules. So that's an increase of 23% for a 14% decrease in time. So definitely less efficient running faster. And with that, our hottest core got up to 100 degrees before it started to throttle a bit. Recovery was about the same time. Clock speed was, of course, a bit higher, with a slightly larger step down when we got into thermal throttling. But I'm going to set it back to regular mode, because that extra 14% in performance is not worth the extra noise, and also running the CPU at 100 degrees is getting a bit iffy. So the key to keeping a mini PC cool is just to use less power. Now, if I'm running my just single core performance test that I did a lot in my previous video, the power consumption goes up to 41 watts. That's like close to the 55 watts that it'll go to, so something seems to be really inefficient. But looking at it with this core temp tool, my core frequency is 5 gigahertz for this thing, whereas before, when I was running the tests, even with the BIOS fast mode, I was only getting to 3.2 gigahertz. So if it's only using one core, it really cranks up the speed to get more performance. And to be able to run a core at 5.2 gigahertz, it needs more voltage, so you basically get a double efficiency hit. So now I'll just run the Pentomino performance benchmark a whole bunch of times, and I'll first run that on one core. So just one instance of it running, and after that stops, you're going to sleep for 4 seconds just to separate it, and now running it on two cores, and we see the power consumption goes up, but not dramatically, but now the clock is lower. And now running with three instances, our clock was only 4.7 gigahertz. Now running it at four instances, clock is 4.4 gigahertz. And the power is not going up at all, so basically the more instances I'm running, it just slows down the CPU a little bit to stay within the power budget. And now putting my test times in a spreadsheet, and I worked out the average speed, 1 over time, and the total speed, because we're running more and more cores over time, and so we're starting everything scaled 1 baseline, we go to 2 cores, the speed per core drops a little bit, but the total amount of work done increases, because we've got 2 cores, power's gone up, we get to 3, and the speed's gone down a little bit more, power is almost steady, and of course the work keeps going up, and by the time we get to 6 cores, we got 4.5 times as much work done, each core is only 77% as fast, and the power has only gone up a bit more than 1.5, so we've almost tripled the efficiency in terms of how much work done per watt. So those performance cores can run a lot more efficiently if I run more of them at the same time. They have to run more efficiently in that case, because with more of them on the die, just because of power constraints, the chip basically just slows them down, which also allows it to reduce the voltage, and that gets a lot more efficiently while only sacrificing some amount of performance. But those performance cores can also use hyper-threading, where each performance core acts as two logical cores, which gets a little bit more performance. So I reran the test with 12 instances running just on the performance cores, and the performance per core, logical core in this case, is half of what it was with a single core. But remember, we have twice as many, so basically we have effectively this performance back, just split across two logical cores. So my net performance is almost 6 times what it was with a single core, while the power consumption is just over 1.5, so the efficiency, which I added here as well, is about 3.5 times as much as it was running single core. And then I reran the tests on the 8 slower efficiency cores. And running on just one efficiency core, I got about 3 cores of performance as I could get out of a single performance core, but at considerably less power, so the efficiency, which I added in blue, is actually greater than the performance cores, of course. And if I run 2, the speed is still the same, and as I get up to 8, the speed drop-off is much less than I had with the performance cores, and so my net performance, if I add the performance of all the cores together, is almost 5 times as much as I got out of one performance core, and is more than running 6 other performance cores because I have less throttling. Now, if I run the performance cores with hyper-threading, I get almost 6 times the performance, whereas here, I only get about 5 times as much. But the efficiency is actually a tiny bit higher than I get here. But on a chip die, this is a performance core, whereas this slightly larger rectangle is 4 efficiency cores, so the area per efficiency core is about 1/3. So I worked out in terms of performance per die area, and with the efficiency cores, I actually get twice as much net performance per square millimeter than with the performance cores, and that's with fewer threads. Now we can get plenty of efficiency out of the performance cores just by running them slower, as I've shown, but in terms of performance per die area, the efficiency cores win, so if you want to get more performance out of a certain size die, using efficiency cores gets you more performance. That's what it's about. And then I rerun my tests with 20 instances going on at the same time, so all performance cores with hyper-threading and all efficiency cores running at the same time. Average performance per core is just 42% what I could get out of a single core. But with 20 cores, I get almost 8.5 times the total performance I got out of a single core, and the efficiency is almost 5 times as much. And my total performance is less than the sum of the performance cores with hyper-threading and the E-cores together because power constraints, so it had to run things even slower to stay at the same power level. And of course, other than video processing and video games, most apps can't really make effective use of 20 cores at the same time, so this isn't always useful, and this is why the performance cores that can go really fast on a single thread or a small number of threads are still very important. Now, this video is sponsored by GEEKOM, a Taiwanese company who provided me with this mini PC, which is their top PC, and now this one, which is their base model at under $300 US, and it uses an AMD processor, which, being a base model, is not the very latest. On the A5, the power maxes out at just over 30 watts versus 55 for the IT13, and that means we have much more efficiency. Performance is about 10 to 20% slower when using those cores. This one doesn't have efficiency cores, but it doesn't need efficiency cores because its cores are actually much more efficient to begin with. So I added this to the spreadsheet that I did for the i9 processor in the GEEKOM IT13, and if we're using just a subset of the cores, the A5 with its Ryzen 5 is only 10 to 20% behind. But if we're using all 20 cores on the i9, it pulls way ahead of this one. But this A5 only costs half as much as the IT13, and it only has half as much RAM at 16 gigabytes and half as much SSD at half a terabyte. Although you can upgrade the RAM or stick another SSD in there. But its performance is well more than half as much. And even under full load, the fan on it never gets to full speed. And what makes the Intel chip less efficient is this chip uses Intel 7 lithography, which, looking that up, is actually a 10 nanometer process, whereas the AMD chip uses 7 nanometer lithography, which is also still not the latest. And lithography size, or transistor size, that makes a big difference in terms of how efficient the chip runs. And why is the AMD chip slower? Well, it's not AMD's latest generation. I'm sure the latest AMD generation is on par with the Intel. So I've really gone down the rabbit hole on this one because I've been curious about these E-cores in terms of how they perform and what their role is in overall performance. Although, in terms of what the actual impact is on what you're using, you're probably best off just to test it with the apps that you're using, which is what pretty much all benchmarks that you see online do. It's just, I wanted to get into the nitty-gritties of things. And in terms of thermal or power throttling, these PCs definitely do it. They use mobile chips. But when I tested my old editing PC, which is a 2020 Core i7, that also throttles for power if you load it down heavily. So this throttling is not specific to mobile, and it's been around for a while. And I've been using that cheaper GEEKOM A5 to edit this video and using it for the past couple of days as my daily driver. It feels totally fast enough. But then I did some tests to see how fast it would open various apps and such, and scaling everything compared to my 2019 Core i7, so the IT13 beats it at almost everything, whereas the A5 is slower at everything, and it's still a bit faster than a 2017 Core i5, but, you know, it's 20% slower than what I'm used to for my old editing PC, so subjectively, it's hard to tell. And here's a fun thing I ended up not actually using. I started monitoring the power with one of these smart plugs that has energy monitoring, but it turns out these don't update very fast. So I rigged up this circuit, which is a current measuring gadget here, and ran that into the scope, and that gives me a very high resolution of power consumption over time. So right now I've just got this program running, which is written in Python, and monitors one of these switches, and we can see the spikes in power consumption when it updates. But running some of my performance tests, the power consumption just jumps around far too much to get a steady state reading, so it wasn't useful for that, and I found using one of these older smart plugs, these give me a brand new reading every full second, and that filters it just enough to get reasonable power readings. But it was kind of fun, so with this updating every second and this triggering and 10 milliseconds per division, I can tell that the update for this thing typically takes 10 milliseconds of CPU processing. And the time resolution here really is to the millisecond. In fact, I had to add a little RC filter on here to filter it down a little bit, because otherwise it was just jumping around way, way, way too much. And once again, this video is sponsored by GEEKOM, and if you want to buy yourself an A5 mini PC, I've got some purchase links for GEEKOM's website or Amazon in the video description.